Anything else about anal scan besides PSMA you want to say? Because I'm just going to finish up the last minute or two with PSMA, unless there's something else we missed about the bone scan, the MRI. We talked about gadolinium, ad nauseum. We've talked about the other types of PET CT scans. Anything else you want to talk about as those side scans? Because I'm done talking about them.
Yeah, I think you covered it very well, Mark. It's nice that we can have a whole section focused on this, because it's all about, in the past, we had to use things like Gleason score, how high the PSA is, how big the nodule is, and we would do a statistical projection and do a guesstimate. Well, we think there's probably a 1 out of 3 chance that there's disease in the lymph nodes. We don't know for sure, because all we've got is this crappy CAT scan to try and determine if there's any cancer. Sometimes the surgeons would use this as an argument and say, well, we just don't know about the lymph nodes, so we want to do surgery on you so we can remove the lymph nodes and look at them under the microscope, as if that's justification for, you know, lifetime mutilation. But this whole issue is so, so important, because now, instead of using these projections, these guesstimates, we're actually getting a scan and looking. Now, does it mean if your PSMA PET scan is clear that there's absolutely no risk of cancer out there? No, it doesn't. All it does is reduce the likelihood of their cancer being out there by at least 50%. So if you have someone with high-risk disease and you do all these calculations, you say, sir, you have an 18% chance that there's metastatic disease outside your prostate. But now we did a PSMA PET scan. It's clear. So if you have something, it's obviously very small, and the chances now that there's something out there is at least 50% lower. So you go from an 18% risk down to maybe a 9% risk. Is that going to change the way you treat that person? Are you going to consider not giving him 1.5 to 2 years of Lupron because you've got a lot stronger evidence that there's nothing spread? I think you are. The other talk that we're going to get into with Dr. Higano, I mean, that was, if I was seeing that for the first time and looking at what all the problems that hormone blockade can cause for men,
yeah,
I'd say, wow, how do I get out of that jail? That's a big deal. And so these PSMA PET scans, I think, offer a window of opportunity for men with high-risk disease that have negative PSMA PET scans to consider maybe foreshortening that routine recommendation of 18 months of hormone therapy. Maybe just do what you would do for intermediate risk, maybe 4 to 6 months would be more plausible in someone with a negative scan.
So just to the audience, Dr. Scholz is talking, and sometimes I start laughing when he says some negative things about some type of surgeons. I laugh because I've known him as long as I've known probably some of my brothers. So, you know, we're sort of Cain and Abel at times, but also very close. So I just laugh because I know who he is.
I think the audience realize that you're just disrespecting me, Mark, but they've been willing to put up with that for years. You know, you have other good qualities, but being the son of a urologist, we understand that you've got a blind spot. I mean, that's okay.
I love surgeons. I think they do an amazing job, and you and I are going to go to our grave fighting this, but I just sometimes laugh because I met you when you were a serious guy, and now you have this humorous side. And whenever you make a joke, it's like Thomas Hope. Whenever you make a joke, I laugh. So I want the audience to understand it's based on the relationship. It's like talking with your brother of 20, 30 years.
No, you're not laughing at the joke. You're laughing at the fact that Scholz told a joke. You're saying, what?
That's true. That's well said. What's better said than it? It's like, yeah, Scholz told a joke? Man, someone lock and load that thing in. Let's put that on the wall as a quotation. Okay. Let's talk about PSA and PSMA. PSA, it was the limitation factor of past scans. You've got to admit that. Here's the nervousness. PSA is going up, and other PET CTs are saying, just let it go to 1, let it go to 1.5, let it go to 2. And I'm going, oh my gosh. So PSMA now can possibly pick up at 0.2. And so is that's, can you again elaborate on that? For someone that's waiting and they're watching their PSA slowly move up after primary therapy and it reaches that threshold, are you confident that in the 0.2s, 0.3s, 0.4s, people should be talking about PSMAs now?
Well, you know, now that someone has to write a check for $3,000, we try and spend their money judiciously. When this is FDA approved, people are going to get a scan right at 0.2 because it'll be covered by insurance. And you say, why not? Let's look. That'll be routine. There is a better chance of finding something at, say, 0.5 to 0.7 than there is at 0.2. So yeah. Someone has to write a check for $3,000 and they want to spend their money wisely, they may wait for it to rise a little higher. There's data in the radiation literature that suggests that, you know, people that get treated with radiation around 0.5 do better than men who get treated with radiation at higher and higher levels. That means that the disease is more likely to be localized at 0.5 than if you allow it to go higher. Maybe it'll turn out around 0.5 is the sweet spot. We have a lot of men that are going to be wondering what's happening after radiation, modern radiation. You know, historically, they would say that if your PSA goes 2 points above the lowest amount, then you're having a relapse. I don't think that's going to be a modern standard with these PSMA PET scans. I think what you're going to tell men after radiation, seed implant, IMRT, proton therapy, that if your PSA starts going above 0.5, you probably need to get a scan and look and see if, God forbid, there's some cancer coming back. And people say, oh, that's such a low level. That's the beauty of these scans. You get rid of this guesswork that we've been dealing with for decades.
That's where you get control. That's where you get cure. That's where you get the words that people want to use, right?